BCAS, Charitable, from the Rahulaji, Chairman, Elect of Chamber of Excellence Secretary. Friends, Diwali vacations are starting. I think this is the last working day and I have seen the crowd. I think more than 120 registration is there. My heartiest congratulations to both the chairmen for very good registration for this seminar. I will start with the definition of NGO defined by the World Bank. A private organization that pursues activities to relieve suffering, promote the interest of poor, protect the environment, provide basic social services, or undertake community development. Friends, NGOs are key partners with any government in carrying social welfare in any society. We professionals can play a major role in this area by formation of trust, custodian of accounts and financial systems, good governance, CSR, audit management, and filing of statutory return as prescribed by the various laws. In morning, I was reading the past article of the Times of India, and I found that for a country which till recently had a weak civil society movement, India is now witnessing a boom in the NGO sector. With a population of 1.2 billion in the country, could well be the land of opportunities for the non-government organizations. With the Central Bureau of Investigation, the estimate is around 20 lakhs NGOs are working in India. Estimated trust state-wise, UP 5,48,000, Kerala 3,69,000, MP around 1,40,000, Maharashtra 1,07,000, Gujarat 75,000. The mind-boggling figure grows down to one NGO per every 600 people. Compare this to latest government data of the police. According to the latest figure from the Union Home Ministry, India has just one policeman for every 943 people, where for 600 people, one NGO is there, sir. But there is an accountability deficit among the NGOs. As per the government sources, this filing of that income tax data, and there is one deficit is there, sir. There was one PIA filed by some advocate, wherein that they told the outcome of PIA is that 90% of the funds are not utilized. Or it is utilized for honorary, traveling, and printing and stationery. The object for the fund utilization for object is very lesser. To educate whole gamut of trust from formation, legal and taxation, the Chamber of Tax is consulted along with the Bombay Chartered Accountants Society. We have organized this seminar. I must acknowledge the efforts of the both the chairman and team, Sri Kamal Alubari, Sri Kanubai Choksi, Manish Keshamalaji, Hindi Ojaji, for designing such a good program for all of us. I would like to appreciate the efforts of our past president, Sri Nitin Bhattacharya, for inviting today's chief guest, Sri Sardar Sahib, Sri Shari Jindal Sahib, and Sardar Sahib, and for designing this program. I also thank to BCAS President Sri Raman for giving his consent for this organizing joint seminar. Friends, Chamber was established in 1946, one of the oldest oriented non-profit organizations formed with the object of educating its member on the direct tax law and other direct law. It has robust membership of around 3,600 members, comprising of chartered accountant, advocates, tax practitioner, corporate member, and student members. Our chamber is also publishing monthly journal, the Chamber Journal, consisting of special story covering the depth analysis on the topic of the interval of the professional interest. I request all of you to become a member of the chamber. kindly visit our website or contact our office. Thank you and great day ahead.
Guest of honor, Sri Shaili Jindal, Chairman of the Session, Sri Dalal, representatives from the Department, President of the Chamber of Ex-Consultant, Sri Abhinashtagam, Sri Kanuka, other dignitaries of the dais, seniors and friends. A very good morning to all of you all. One of the annual features of the Bombay Chartered Society is to organize at least one seminar or workshop on charitable trust. This year, the Corporate and Allied Trust Committee of this society has taken the initiative, along with the Chamber of Tax Consultant, of organizing this class guide seminar. As you all may be aware that BCAS has been a pioneer in knowledge dissemination and harnessing of talent since 1949. It has more than 9,000 members. BCAS, through its foundation, have been participating in various philanthropic activities and have been contributing in for the building of the schools and hospitals in the flood ravaged areas of Jammu and Kashmir and Himachal Pradesh, and even at the time of the devastating earthquake of the Gujarat. It is gratifying to know the agenda of the seminar, which has been thoughtfully structured by the two professional bodies, to make it very relevant not only for the professionals but also for the trust, by covering a wide spectrum of subjects which will cover gamut of important and modern issues. We have participants coming from various parts of the country, like Chennai, Delhi, Jaipur, Aurangabad, Pune, Ahmednagar, and also more important is participation from the NGO bodies themselves. Can I, by show of hands, can I know how many are participating from the NGO? Anyone from the NGOs? So, I need the first hand knowledge. To kickstart the seminar, we have none other than the Charity Commissioner himself, C.S.B. Saule, who readily agreed to give a keynote address. We are indeed highly obliged to him. He should be joining us in a moment. To take it forward, we do not have a better faculty than the Deputy Commissioner himself to speak on the important procedural aspects for the trustees and the professionals. But what is here for the charities? What is the path forward? Who could be better than our beloved Arinda Dalal to guide us and show us the road ahead for charities? It is known fact that many trusts have had problems in getting this 12-year registration due to certain clauses in the trust deed which are not acceptable to the department, and they have to go back to the charity commissioner for getting these amendments notified. And wasting considerable time going back and forth. To guide us through the drafting skills for the trust deed, we have none other than Sri Vipinbhai Vatavia, who will also touch upon the important role of management of the Trust Act. Sri Paresh Sawla will take us through the formation of the trust under the MPT Act, the Society Registration Act, Companies Act, and the registration procedures of the LWA. The latest news reveals that more than 8,000 NGOs, FCRA registrations have been cancelled for various reasons. The FICRA has been recently amended and has been made more onerous. The NDA government has proposed a series of amendments to FICRA to strengthen the scrutiny of financial transactions involving NGOs. To take us through the FCRA and also to guide us how the NGOs can help the companies in mitigating their CSR obligations, we are really fortunate to have the experience of Sri Shailesh Bhattacharya. The most vexing problem faced by the trust is the interpretation of the provision of the Income Tax Act. Recently, the requirement has been quite stringent and I am at times unreasonable. In dealing with this trust, and they have got their own strong reasons, Sri Rajesh Bhai Kadakya will share his domain knowledge of the test aspects. I am sure that after all these sessions, we still have some few questions left, and the last session, the Q&A session, will guide us and help us get our answers. Before I request Mr. Kamal Kanuka to introduce the chief guest and the guest of honor, I would like to sincerely thank the coordinators of the seminar, Mr. Amani Sisamala and P.T. Goza from BCAS, and Mr. Vipinder Patel and Kala Dhanamma from the chamber for putting a lot of hard work in designing and formalizing and making it a grand success. And a special thanks to the chairman of the corporate and allied law committee, Mr. Karun Choksi, who could not be here because of some social issues. And a special welcome to Mr. Sahil Jindal for being present here and giving us his remarks on this talk, important topic of shared with us. Before I hand over the proceedings to Mr. Karun Taluka, let me wish you all a very happy Diwali. Thank you.
Yeah,
yeah, certainly, sir. Good morning, friends. Introduction and felicitation will be done after arriving of our chief guest. And I request chairman of this session, Kavin Kailal, to take over the session.
Exemption
regarding the subject of labor crunch. The first point which I would like to stress is whether it is necessary for a person or a trust to produce either the application to the Deputy Commissioner or registration under the Maharashtra Public Trust Act before the application can be accepted by the Internet Department for the purpose of registration in the section in my opinion, it is not necessary to go to action and independence, and it is not necessary that the application for registration under Section 12A or 12A can be accepted only when the application for registration under the Maharashtra Public Trust Act is produced. It should not be necessary, though, as a matter of practice, actually, this is what is being insisted that by applying for registration under 12A, this application is also being asked for. And so, in my opinion, it is not necessary to do so because both the acts are independent, they are not linked together, and therefore, if an entity is entitled to registration as a charitable trust under Section 12A or 12A of the Protect Act, there is no reason why the application should not be accepted by the Interpretive Department for the purpose of proceeding for the registration under Section 12A. Of course, the trust must fulfill the conditions of Section 12A before it can be registered, and that will be verified by the department whether the conditions of Section 12A and 12A are fulfilled. The critical part which we can consider is that if the Health Commissioner is using registration, say due to loan to trustees, but loan is permitted as per the Income Tax Act under Section 22. So the question is that it is it will be creating a difficulty if the loan given to such a trust to the city registration has been received registration by the Maharashtra Public Trust Act. In my opinion, that should not be a question, so long as the trust is actually fulfilling the address of the purpose. And since there is no connection, as I said, between the two acts, it is not necessary that an application which has been rejected by or not granted registration under the Maharashtra Public Trust Act because of the loan given to the trustee is not accepted by the, should not be accepted by the Income Tax Department. I think the DIT Exemption can take a different view whether it is acceptable or not and proceed with the matter of registration. In fact, I have mentioned that there is a common mistake or rather common view which is there by many chapter authors, particularly that you cannot give a loan to a trustee or cannot deal with a trustee in the course of your decision. But you should bear in mind the provisions of sections 13.2 and 13.3 in the Income Tax Act by which the loans to the trustees or the rental of the property given to the trustee, etc., are permitted under Section 32, provided the rate of interest and the security are reasonable. If that is so, then both the conditions must be fulfilled. It should not be merely that the rent should be reasonable or correct, but also there must be a security from the rental income. Secondly, similarly, if a loan is given to a trustee, such a trust must pay adequate rate of interest for the purpose of the loan given. And likewise, if you consider the various clauses which are 8 in number, Section 32, then you will find that there can be a service rendered by the trustee to the trust or service available by the trust to the public trustee. Provided the remuneration is reasonable or if any property or securities are sold or purchased, then they also are permitted to attend the the price for this kind of a kind is reasonable. The one particular clause which creates difficulty in the case of many trusts is the question of a benefit or income diverted to the trustee. It's a very low limit of 1,000 rupees which is today worth nothing. The section, the provision of that clause is that if the amount below such 1,000 rupees, then it will not apply, but if it is above 1,000, then the law will apply. And therefore, in most of the cases, it is a diversion of benefits to the trust, then it will have to be put, it will have to be the test of reasonableness or test of not giving any benefit to the trust to be put. And likewise, the investment also must be considered, must be according to Section 5 for the purpose of registration. The other compensation is arising on account of Section 3, where, as you are aware, the categories of persons covered are many. One of them, starting with the author, founder, and substantial contributors, who are defined as persons who are given a benefit of a donation or benefit of 50,000 rupees in a lifetime to their trust. These three categories of persons will be considered as the governed under Section 13(3) of the CAP. And if it is an HF donation to the trust, then all the members of the HF also will be governed under 13(3). Likewise, the trustees as well as the manager of the institution are covered under Section 13(3). And all the relatives of this, which are calling as well as 19 categories, will also be covered by Section 13(3). Therefore, the trust will have to be always careful to see that there is no breach of Section 13(3) in trying to acquire another trust. We had a very typical case in the course of our practice where we found that the trust had given, the trust was from here from Bombay, the benefit was being given in Gujarat and the rest of the universities at Bharuch. And since the branch, the trust had no branch in Bharuch, it used to give the money to the company in which the chairman of the trust, board of trustees, was dead. And after the question arose that if a loan is being given, trust is administering the trust through the company, is a limited company, and whose chairman is again a trustee, whether this will be hit by provision of Section 13(3). Prima facie, it looks as if that when the loan is given, when the amount is advanced to the part of the training of charity, it will be covered. But firstly, we must understand that it's not a loan, because it's an advance given for the purpose of the spending for charity. And therefore, it's not an amount which is going to be returned to the trust, but an amount which is going to be dispersed. And secondly, the trust was availing of the benefit of the company of this establishment, whereby the costs that saved that would trust and the, as for the relation of the trustees, the charity was being dispersed by the company. Now the department took the view that since the chairman of the company is also a trustee in the company which is there in Gujarat, this would be a case which would be hit by Section 13(3). But on detailed consideration of the clauses of Section 13(3), it was found that it did not fulfill, it did not affect the provisions of Section 13(3) so as to attack the provisions of the tax. It was argued in the tribunal that, detailed speaking, the company whose statement was the trustee of the trust did not affect the provisions of the breach, and after legal argument, the tribunal accepted that this was not covered, the matter is referred to the Royal High Court, and now the pending before the not the Royal High Court, but the High Court, and now the matter is pending before the High Court, whether such a case is covered by the breach of the trustee. So these are some of the difficult individual drivers that I have but the more important common problems today are the cases where the pressure of registration by the PAT exemption is refused on the ground that it is not the breaking condition of the Act. Now, the department has been indicating that if the trust or the trustees are carrying on any commercial activities, then that is a condition which is a breach of the provisions of the Act, and therefore the decision is refused. In a number of cases, I have gone to the tribunal operation here, and the tribunal reversed cases in most of the cases because the question of 215 provisional does not affect as far as the decision is concerned under section 28 or 28. The only condition to submit as far as the section is concerned is that the person concerned with genuine activities and the activity will be performed as well as the fee of the interest. If there is so, then there is no breach. And the tribunal has reversed the decision of not granting or refusing their decision in both of the cases. Even now, so many cases are being reversed by the tribunal. The last category of cases where the difficulty arise is a Finance Act 2015 amendment which has been made by the government in order to actually relieve the difficulties, but it is going to create more difficulties. The section has been amended to provide that if the relations which are entered into by the jailers, 50% thereof of out of the total conditions are within the law, then there is no difficulty in the decision. But if the transition section is 50% of the transitions of the entire year, then it will be forfeiting the exemption and not entire transition. Now, this was a measure for eliminating the supplementing doctor to reduce the difficulty, but instead of reducing the difficulties, it will create difficulty because 50% of the conditions then it will be easily created. You may consider that the government has appointed the another committee to consider the difficulties of the Imported Act, and I am sure it is going to be decided by Mr. President of the tribunal is going to decide with the committee and consider the entire Act for amendment within a period of 4 months. I'm not sure whether within a period of 4 months the committee can be can come up with a new Act, but let us hope that this committee will try to remove it within the committee and go from various as far as the registration under the Maharashtra Public Trust Act is concerned, let me confess that since I am not allowed to appear before the Trade Commissioner and the Chartered Accountant, then I do not have any practical experience of various provisions of the implementation of various provisions of the Act. But let me give this two tips, common cases which are created. The first difficulty is that the Trade Commissioner sometimes takes two of the land in order to register the trust. And if there is a position, then the trust which is not yet registered under the Income Tax Act because of the dealing registered in Maharashtra Act, so it should not be able. The same thing will create difficulty as far as the tax sector under the provisions of tax. We had one of the case of a very big, large association called NASCOM. And NASCOM is one of the very important organizations within the public affairs. And the matter was lying with the entire commission of the very long period before deciding whether it should be 50% decision or not. And finally, it was registered. And the question arises whether NASCOM should now fulfill the conditions of all the provisions of the Maharashtra Government Act for a period of almost 6-7 years for which it was functioning in the decision and the public protest. Secondly, when the Charitable Commission takes long time to decide whether the object is charitable or not, or whether the object does not fall within the purview of the Public Trust Act, then also again, there is a difficulty as far as the trust is concerned, but it will not be registered under the State Act and the Income Tax Act also. The registering of the case of the Public Trust Act should take view one year under the within period of 6 months, that we have a 6 month period in under the income tax side deputy, and here also the representative is decided very fast. The other question is that I think there are, since there is no deep between the Europe, I mean with the Trust Act and the Income Tax Act, what is the position of the British questions arising under the Income Tax Act and the Trust Act? Supposing that the Trade Commissioner has taken a decision whereby a loan is given to the trust and the Trade Commissioner finds that the loan is onerous, the issue of the loan are onerous for the purpose of the trust, and therefore such a loan is not approved by the Trade Commissioner. The question is whether, as far as the Income Tax Act is concerned, there should be any duty. Now, if the tax offer is fine, then as far as the loan is concerned, there is no difficulty in the administration of the loan and the use of money, then I think the authorities under the Income Tax Act are not bound to be affected by the decision of the Charity Commission. They can take an independent view and go ahead with the decision, even if the loan is given by the trust, if the Charity Commission considers them not permissible. The authorities under the Income Tax Act may consider that it is legitimate. And since under 13(2) loan is permitted, provided the security and interest are reasonable, there should be no difficulty. And lastly, we must also consider that there are some distinctions between the investment permitted under 11(5) under the Income Tax Act and under the provisions of the Maharashtra Public Trust Act. Though most of the items are common, there are some differences between the two, and therefore one has to be always careful in trying to see that the investment is not only fulfilling the conditions of the Income Tax Act, but also is fulfilling the conditions of the Public Trust Act. That is one more feature that would take us into the country. Consider the some of the practical inquiries which arise in the course of the decision and administration of the trust. As I mentioned, that the commission is in the part that we take proper care to see that the difficulties that we face both under the Income Tax Act and the trust will be removed, and the trust will be able to go ahead because the intention behind the formation of the trust is to allow them to function freely in the interest of the charity and not create objections. I think these are the one point which I have noted. My intention was also, if my talk was after the speech by the Charity Commissioner as well as the Compliance General, but since the process has been reversed, I will, if I got to, if there is any observation by them, which I find it worth commenting on, worth discussing, and I will take them on. Thank you very much for your patient hearing to this. give his observation and also tell me how many mistakes I have made in trying to discuss the resolution of the meeting.
Shortcoming of the objection, unless the issue is settled, the department is bound to accept their view and take remedial action in so many cases. So initially what we did, we rejected the registration, but of late we have been able to solve this problem by taking an affidavit and some sort of undertaking from the trustees that in case of resolution, the properties or the properties of the trust will go to similar other trusts. And in the trust act also, it is already provided that in case of resolution, it will be dissolved under certain provisions of the act, which clearly provides that it will, none of it will go to the trustees, it will go to the similar other trust. But we expect that this point should be clearly mentioned. Charity Commissioner is not there, unfortunately. So I was thinking of requesting him also that he should allow, because somebody has pointed out to me that Charity Commissioner office does not accept that clause, and they say that this is not, will not accept it. So I thought that I will make him a request also, but to our loss, he is not there. So you may
he's coming.
Okay, fine. By the time will come, I speak with you. And there is one more aspect which, see, these days we are in the age of computers and making copies and making I have come across one or two instances where middle pages of the trust deeds have been changed and the objects have been altered to, you know, to suit it to the requirement of the income tax office. So I would make a suggestion that there is no harm in stamping all the pages of the trust deed so as to make it secure, because these days these are completely pages and it is very easy to, you know, replicate anything and create a duplicate document, this, that. And we always come across so many things on a daily basis. So it would be in the interest of the charity department as well as in our interest that these things are incorporated.
Earlier, when
ATG application being made, we were insisting that you must do some activity. And we were only accepting 12-way applications initially, and after issue of 12-way, we were accepting ATG application. But of late, in order to facilitate and help the genuine trust, we have been accepting both applications at the same time. But the process is the first issue 12-way, and then only after issue of 12-way, we can issue ATG. And my request to you is because Mr. Alwani has pointed out, so many trusts and charities have been registered. And at the same time, many non-genuine charities have also been, FCRA registrations have been cancelled. So my request to you as a responsible chartered accountant, as a responsible, because you and I as a department are both sets the same coin. So it is not my duty, but your duty also to discourage non-genuine activity and not take up those matters for some, if it is in your knowledge, you should advise the charity that please don't do this and I cannot be part of the same. So it is advisable to have some activity done before you approach us for ATG. Legally, it is difficult for us to refuse your application, but an amount of suspicion remains. So I would request you that before approaching us for ATG registration, please ask the trust to do some charitable activities, show it to us so that we can be confident by issuing the ATG certificates. One more thing I would like to point out. The department has started e-filing website, but the problem is only income tax returns which are uploaded on the website are accepted. Many persons, I have come across 2-3 applications where application for registration and a 12-way as well as ATG have been uploaded on the website, and the website also generates a receipt that acknowledgement that this form has been uploaded. But the provision of the Act does not support that application because the application under section ATG and 12-way is to be accompanied by certain documents before the officer, and then only it can be accepted. Unless a formal amendment is made to the provision of the Act for creating that application, please don't make any such application because it will create a dispute in the sense that I have uploaded the application and that should be taken as a date of application. So in my opinion, it is not a valid application. You may upload the data, but legally that has no section. With this, I have nothing more to say, but I would request that charities are a very sensitive section, unlike the other provisions of the Income Tax Department where there is endless litigation going on. So we both from the departmental side as well as from your side have to be very careful in making use of the provisions of the Act, as it goes in a long way in helping the society. At times, many genuine charity activities are getting affected because of slight neglect on the part of the department as well as on the part of the practicing side. So we must take due care and observe the discipline. Since it is Diwali time, and probably Mr. Rani said that it is the last working day, so I wish you all a very happy Diwali for you and your family.
Thank you, Mr. General. Friends, let us begin with beginning. I invite the dignitaries of the dais for Master Sati Madana by IIT Bombay. Thank you.
June 2001.
is a senior partner in AS Dalal & Company, Mumbai. He has contributed papers at seminar conferences on subject of professional interest. He has also written article on income tax company laws and has authored following books: Texas Government Public Charitable Trust, Tax Audit Manual, Joint Author, History of ICA, joint author with C.P. Shah. He was member of Central Council from 1985 to 1991, has been chairman and has served as a various committee during the tenure of the council. He has been chairman of the Company Law and Research Committee. He has also been a member of the Western India Research Council of the Institute, and he was its treasurer in 1959-60 and chairman in 62-63. He was vice president of the Institute of Chartered Accountant and also became president in 1989-90. He was a delegate in to the 13th World Congress of Accounts held in Tokyo, Japan in October 1987. He led the delegation of the Institute of the Kappa Conference held in Seoul in September 1989. He was representing the Institute on an International Audit Practices Committee of IFAC for 2.5 years from 1989 to 1991. He was chairman of the Perspective Planning Group of the Institute in 1991. He was appointed a member of the expert group constituted by CBT on leasing industry. He is ex-chairman, member of the Accession Committee of BCAS Society and a member of its Accounting and Auditing Committee. He was the president of Bombay Chartered Accountant Society in 63-64. He is a member of various subcommittees of Chamber of Tax Consultants. He is a trustee of Eddie Shroff Memorial Trust and a member of Council of Management of Foreign of Free Enterprises. With this illustrious career, I request you all to please welcome with loud round. So friends, it's a time to felicitate the dignitaries. First, our chief guest, CASB Savle. I request our past president, CTC, C.A. Vipin Batavia, to do the honors. Guest of honor, Sri Sevi Jindal. I request Vice President of Bombay Chartered Accountant Society, C.A. Chetan Sir, to do the honor. Charitable Commissioner from Mumbai, Mr. Vyas. please come forward. I request CA Manish Desamala to welcome him, please. Assistant Charity Commissioner from Pune, Mr. Chakta. I request Vice President CTC, Mr. Bharat Savla, to welcome him. From Income Tax Department, IUS Jameson, Mr. Chauhan, please come forward. I request Mr. Anil Sharma to come forward and welcome, please. Lastly, Mr. Sari Kahire, IUS Jameson. Please come forward. I request Ms. Siti Oja to come forward and welcome, please. Thank you, friends. The meeting is spent, and let us come back to where we have left. And I hand over to chairman of the session, Arvind Agarwal, to take on the proceedings.
Trustees, all these constituents of the charity organization. So I must
be very much thankful to Bombay Chartered Accountant Society, and I would compliment them and I would always fully support them to conduct such programs and make the trustees and all the concerned aware of the necessary provisions in laws and the things which are required to be done by all of us. As I said, trustees, chartered accountants and charity commissioners are the major constituents of the charity organization. Their roles are very specific. Trustees manage chartered accountants' account and the charity commissioners watch. This process has to be streamlined. The thing is that streamlining of this process is necessary because whatever though is satisfactory is not, I'm sorry to say, best. There are expectations of our office from the trustees. There are expectations of trustees from our office. And there are expectations of people at large from the entire charity organization. So unless we are able to fulfill these expectations of each other, we cannot say that we are doing best. So we must achieve, we must go towards the best. What we can do for that is a question. Delay is a major stigma for this entire process. Delay in accepting the change reports, delay in recording the important events in the trust, delay in recording the purchase properties, sale, etc. All these things will have to be absolutely controlled. The matter level based to bring it under control. So far as our office is concerned, we are going towards the technology also. We are going to adopt online submissions of change reports, of society registration applications, and will be perhaps successful within 6 months of processing these particular formalities within a very short time, with a very little effort, and perhaps we will see that the trustees did not visit our office. Of course, I feel that one way the trustee, you know, is so much accustomed with visiting our office that if we stop all these activities, you know, we would get bored. But anyway, I wish that the time invested in attending our office can be utilized for the necessary social work, etc. So with this, I can say that there would be a material, a social reform, a great major reform in our system. But at the same time, something is expected from the trustees also. And so far as today's function is concerned, today's seminar is concerned, I would be concentrating mainly on the submission of the statement of accounts. On this aspect, I think awareness among the trustees is very necessary. You may perhaps be not knowing or perhaps be knowing also, there are around 70 lakhs trustees in this state. 7.5 lakhs is the number of the trust registered trust, and around 70 lakhs persons are working as trustees, a very huge number that way. And you will be surprised if we are strict in finding out as to how much of the trustees are abiding the provisions in law. And I'm sorry to say, you may not please get hurt, but I can say that about more than 70 to 80% trustees are not abiding the provisions in the Act. And it's a matter of really worry that if the department intends to take action against the trustees who are not abiding the provisions in the Act, then almost 40 lakhs trustees can be prosecuted under Section 66 and 67 of the Act of Corporations. I'm making this statement very responsible. therefore, I must compliment this Bombay Chartered Accountant Society who has taken this work, this task in their hand to make the trustees aware of this provision. It's really necessary. So far as the problem which the chartered accountants generally face for in submitting their accounts, sir, even Mr. Jindal also has trust in that aspect. They are taking utmost care for accepting the statements of accounts. You will see that the statement of accounts, though they are suffering from some latches, they will not be making that as a reason for refusing their rejecting them. Coincidentally, today we are organized, we are conducting a meeting of the Joint Chartered Commissioners in the state in my office to discuss on this subject. It's clearly coincident. Our meeting was planned in last month, and I think I could receive this invitation just few days ago. But that it is indicates that we have a common intention, common desire to do something in the interest of the world. So that aspect definitely is going to be solved. Generally, the chartered accountants or the trustees face one problem. If there is a delay in submitting the accounts, our officers on account of delay either do not accept them, or sometimes there are orders refusing the accounts on account of delay. I have therefore suggested my all the officers that it is not in the interest of the charitable organization itself to refuse any or to not take on record any statement of it. It is so because unless the statements are on record, the organization will not be able to know as to what was the income of the trust during that particular year. Fortunately for us, since 2008, we are not asked to pay the 2% contribution. All the trusts are taking rest in paying payment of that amount. But you'll have to take a note that this will not be relaying you from your liability to pay the 2% amount of contribution. It is because of some interim order of the High Court, and perhaps we are making effort and making a request to the High Court to modify that particularly that direction so that the recovery can be again started. So if this is so, recovery of the areas of last 6 years also can be there. So the trustees therefore may not be negligent in maintaining accounts, submitting the accounts properly in time. Our chartered accountants are also expected therefore to be very punctual, because I think many of the chartered accountants are generally on the panel of some trust. Or they can sensitize the other trust also who are negligent towards submitting the accounts. So this type of awareness, this type of spreading knowledge by the chartered accountants in general is really expected. So if this is done, I think we will be able, it's a really notable figure. In 2008, when we stopped collecting the 2% contribution, the collection was to the extent of about 150 crore, and the gross income was around 50 times this figure. Now, in 2015, if we start collecting this 2%, the amount would be into 80,000 crore. Gross income of the trust would be 80,000 crore, and 2% of it would be around 1,600. So this can be the amount which can be collected by the charity organization, and I think it would be half, around 8% of the revenue which has been collected by the state. So I think charity organization may be the first department collecting this much revenue. Perhaps a note of this was taken by the High Court, and the High Court observed that when you are collecting this much amount and not spending it, the High Court perhaps stopped us from making the recovery. But in this gathering, I may suggest that all of us can make an effort.
But this amount, if it's recovered, is more than sufficient for meeting the needs of our officers. The remaining can be invested for the charitable purposes by the state. The entire amount, in fact, should be used for the charitable purposes, not for only running the charity offices. If that thing we can buy off some amendment or some notifications change here, this process perhaps will not be continuous. There will not be any halt in recovering the amount of 50%. So with this perspective also, awareness amongst all the trustees to maintain the accounts properly, to submit them in time, is very necessary. I think Nana's take it you, because this much was the only message I wanted to send. I have really taken note of, and perhaps a serious note of, non-submission of the accounts in time. At the cost of repetition, I tell you that more than 50% of the trust, 3.5 lakh trust, are not submitting their accounts in time. So the department will have to perhaps take coercive actions against. We have been warned also accordingly. And if we take such a course and take such an action, the trustees may not be perhaps shocked. The trustees may not have in that case any defense also, because it's a case of purely documentary evidence. The law says that intention of the trustee is also not material in such a case. Whether he had deliberately done it or whether he has not deliberately done it will not be the consideration at all. So the act of or omission of not submitting the accounts can be taken so serious cognizance. So today I think sir, we may be from all the departments of the state, we'll try to give a signal to the public at large by making a declaration, I think. And all of us are really expecting from you to be law-abiding and do everything as per the provisions in law so that the harmony between us can be maintained. Thank you.
One good thing, sir, I think Prasad has started the cleanness, I think, over there. I was discussing with sir that change in report acceptance. I think he has started in the month of September at around 11,005 years created within a month. What sir is saying, only about the law, but they are also coming towards the public service actually.
And we are both the organization, we thank you for that, sir. And thank you for the
thank you, Dr. Sir. Charities and others work, but have to be carried out cautiously, both in the view of charity commissioner and commissioner income tax agencies. We are thankful to our chief guest, CSD Sabale, who took out his valuable time with his team to raise this occasion and accept the chief guest and hear his view. And his expectation from us, chartered accountant, professional, and from the trustees. Thank you very much, sir. Sally Jindal sir is already doing the good work, so we should congratulate him. And we again thank him for taking all his valuable time on this holiday to address us. Thank you very much, sir. Before I conclude, Mr. Dalal has some point to address, please.
Yes, we are already late, but I would like to mention specifically two or three points, another 2 points from Mr. Dindal's address. Firstly, resolution clause. The department's revision is a resolution clause in the the view in the profession is that the trust is a perpetual entity, and if it doesn't contain any clause, situation, then the trust does not become invalid. And therefore, I had an appeal against that condition where the tribunal accepted immediately the bank.
Appeals are being allowed by tribunals, but since it is a revenue objection, we have to.
Yeah, that's right. But ultimately, I suppose that it will be better. And the second point is, activity must be done before the trust can be registered. Now, this was only started by Kerala, as far as you are aware. And in a particular case, the fact that such that Kerala High Court gave the judgment that, no, you must have activity. But thereafter, many judgments have gone where it has been held that it is not necessary to have actual activity before the trust can be registered. The trust did not have letter of debt and other requirements for the movement. In that event, it is not necessary that you must start the activity. One of the cases it was argued that if the trustee wants to apply for registration on the very first day, the trust is constituted. Is there anything to prevent the tribunal held that no, there is nothing to prevent the trust from applying for registration even though the activities are not starting? And there are times when there are no more cases that have been held that actual activities are not. So these are the two points which I have not had.
The point that I was trying to make was the point that I was trying to make was that there's no legal bar in issuing material as our office has been issuing, but it creates more problems for us in differentiating the genuine and non-genuine charity. So it was my appeal to you that if possible, please come to us after doing some work. Otherwise, I mean, as per the Act, I cannot relate to that. I have to do it. But then, some more inquiry and some more quizzing and some more questions. That could be the thing.
Yes.
It is clear as
so one more minute, sir. And to complete this, there is a lot of things. Provoking approach of Jindal sir. Who has to go to him for more and more queries in this role? Thank you, Jindal sir. Lastly, Arvind, there was a we cherish your knowledge and always learn from your experience. And we thank you very much for his presence and guidance and act as chairman of this session. And now I request propose adding word of thanks, so I request to get your to in government. Thank you. Friends, now we have a break for breakfast. I request you all to come there.